One of the most challenging elements of building games that are reliant on procedural generation is maintaining a sense of novelty as familiarity grows in the minds of the player. As you dive into this pseudo-random crafted experience, you need to ensure players become more familiar with the mechanisms at play and the underlying progression, but you run risk of that becoming stale very quickly. I'm Tommy Thompson, and in this Smoke and Mirrors episode, let's talk about the procedural generation framework of Dead Cells, developed by Motion Twin and released in 2018. Dead Cells is but one of many games in recent years that's taken the formula of roguelikes, or roguelike-likes if you want to get anal about it, popularised by Spelunky, where you introduce roguelike elements of procedural level design and permadeath to game genres that veer away from the original turn-based non-modal format of rogue. This includes games like Binding of Isaac and FTL to games like Slay the Spire and 20XX, a roguelike inspired by Mega Man that I already talked about on Smoke and Mirrors. In this instance, Dead Cells is inspired from Metroidvanias, whereby each dungeon is a large expansive environment that rewards players for methodical exploration and finding all of the weapons, items, and upgrades hidden throughout. It's a difficult balancing act given you want to reward exploration in a game that continually procedurally generates, but also you want to find a way to maintain a sense of novelty. While pseudo-randomness in level design is great, sometimes resulting in interesting and quirky level layouts and configurations, it can easily become a little staid. Even if a given area of a level is technically new and fresh, given the player hasn't seen it before, it doesn't feel novel, given it's so similar to something we've already seen, and this is a problem games from Surefooting all the way to No Man's Sky have to deal with, maintaining familiarity whilst also introducing novelty. Dead Cells addresses this in a number of ways. One that's common among many games is the introduction of permanent upgrades and item unlocks, something the game shares with the likes of 20XX. But Motion Twin also introduced something else into the level generation system. It continually adds new layers to the game over the opening hours of play, be it items, mechanics, game modes and features, and those help reinforce player progression and maintain novelty through mystery. When you first start out in the game, it's pretty straightforward. You awaken in a dead body, get some brief exposition, pick up a weapon or two, and start hacking through the dungeon. The novelty is at its peak. You're still figuring out the mechanics, the weapons, the enemy types, and how Dead Cells really works. Ultimately, you'll die and return back to the start, and your gooey fleshy head climbs into a new body. But with each new death, we see new elements emerge within the game. This is readily apparent in starting halls when your new body forms. Game modes such as the Daily Challenge are introduced to the side, the main room full of permanent unlocks appears that shows everything you've accrued to date, plus new rooms for items and upgrades begin to appear in the areas between levels. This is reflecting on your progression with the cell-consuming unlock system, while the door to the Daily Challenge is opened by finding a rune item in the world. But while this might feel a tad superficial, given it's the same item unlock system I already mentioned, we see changes in the output of the procedural generation system. New level templates are introduced, new biomes are revealed to us, each with their own level features, and new rooms that deliver small amounts of exposition that slowly unpack what has happened to this world we're trapped within. What seems like a linear progression, from the opening dungeon, the prisoner's quarters, to the promenade of the condemned and the ramparts begins to fracture. The toxic sewers and the ossuary can appear before the first boss, the concierge. In each case, there are distinct enemy types and level features that help maintain that novelty. It becomes less like rote learning of the routes and locations than an exercise in honing your gameplay skills such that you adapt to each biome. Perhaps most interesting is that the game starts introducing elements that imply new unlocks still await, given there are interactable elements that seem to do nothing at first, only to later make sense as you make more progress within the game. Green blobs on the ground that do nothing at first, only to later create vine ladders once you've unlocked the vine rune in the Promenade of the Condemned. Or the sarcophagi that allow you to teleport that can only be activated after unlocking the teleportation rune in the toxic sewers. The level features these items enable stack atop one another, so you might start seeing numerous elements that suggest there is still more secrets to be found. Right now, I've still got a long way to go before I master this game, and there are still new features being presented whose mysteries I've yet to uncover, and I'm actively avoiding looking them up on the internet to maintain the suspense. It's always a difficult balancing act, but Dead Cells does well to maintain the player's interest after several hours of failure. There's still more to see, there's still more to be found, and rather than simply hoping there's more content after you beat the game, it's promising it to you as a reward for your commitment. Thanks for watching this episode of the newly reformatted Smoke and Mirrors. Let me know if you're liking this new approach. And don't forget, you can watch Smoke and Mirrors early on Patreon and support the AI and Games show in the process. Stay safe, have fun, I'll be back.